نحمده ونصلي على رسوله الكريم أما بعد فأعوذ بالله من الشيطان الرجيم بسم الله الرحمن الرحيم يا أيها الناس اعبدوا ربكم الذي خلقكم والذين من قبلكم لعلكم تتقون الذي جعل لكم الأرض فراشا والسماء بناء وأنزل من السماء ماء وأنزل من السماء ماء فأخرج به من الثمرات رزقا لكم فلا تجعلوا لله أندادا وأنتم تعلمون صدق الله العظيم رب اشرح لي صدري ويسر لي أمري واحلل عقدة من لساني يفقهوا قولي اللهم ربنا ألهمنا رشدنا وأعذنا من شرور أنفسنا اللهم أرنا الحق حقا وارزقنا اتباعه وأرنا الباطل باطلا وارزقنا اجتنابه اللهم وفقنا لما تحب وترضى آمين يا رب العالمين Dear brothers and sisters, assalamu alaikum wa rahmatullahi wa barakatuh. We are now beginning with the third section of Surah Al-Baqarah. You might have noted that the two basic terminologies I am keeping as such, I am not translating them. Ayah or ayat, it cannot be translated. Surah, it cannot be translated. But ruku, I am translating into sections. As I told you, this terminology was not present in the times of the Prophet sallallahu alaihi wasallam as well as the days of the Sahaba radiyallahu ta'ala anhum ajma'in. It was a later day addition. So we can translate. We can adopt another words also. But please note one thing, that these paras or parts, I am translating ajza also into parts, ruku sections. As far as the rukus go, this division seems to be very connected logically with the subject of that those ayat. Very clear distinction, very correct distinction. But as regards the paras or the parts, you know, it's a very word I should say, I can't decide, but it's not at all a correct division into paras. Because even the surahs have been divided. And we find at least in one place in Surah Al-Hijr, one ayah is in the 13th part and the rest of the whole surah is in the 14th part. So it's not a very good division. But as far as the rukus are concerned, the division is very correct and logical. Now this third section, or third ruku of Surah Al-Baqarah, as I told you, gives us a gist or summary of the call of the Qur'an. What's the dawah of Qur'an? First of all, Ya Ayyuhal Nas, note that this call is to the whole of humanity. Ya Ayyuhal Nas. We must note in the Makki surahs, when Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala describes the history of most of the messengers of Allah, we find the word Ya Qawmi, Ya Qawmi Ibudullah, O my people, O my nation. Be obedient to Allah, serve Allah, be bondmen to Allah. But this is the distinction between the message of Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam and the message of the former messengers. That was directed to their nations only. And this message is addressed to the whole of humanity. Ya ayyuhan nas ubudu rabbakum. Ibadah. Obedience with love. Both things must be together to convey the sense of ibadah. Total obedience to someone out of extreme love for him. If the obedience is not out of love, it's due to some pressure, then it's obedience only, not ibadah. If a nation conquers another nation, that conquered nation is obedient to the conqueror, but they are not doing ibadah to them. The ibadah is when the obedience is total, number one, and it is from the depths of the heart, out of extreme love for someone. So if someone loves Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala from the depths of his heart, and as a result of that love, he obeys him in all the aspects of his life, then he is doing the ibadah. He is fulfilling the purpose of his creation. Because this subject has been very extensively discussed in the Makki surahs. In Surah Zariyat we find, وَمَا خَلَقْتُ الْجِنَّ وَالْإِنْسَ إِلَّا لِيَعْبُدُونَ. I have not created men and jinn except only to obey me, to worship me, to love me, to be bondsmen to me, to serve me. This is the sole purpose of the creation of the jinns as well as the humans. And we find that all the messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they convey the same message to their nations. Ya qawm ibudullah, ma lakum min ilahin ghayru. All the messengers. This was the common call of all the messengers. That is the call of Quran. The same is the call of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. The only difference is that they were addressing their nations only. And this prophecy of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, this prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam is universal to the whole of humanity. But the essence is the same. O Badullah, be bondsmen to Allah, obey Allah in all aspects of your life, individual as well as collective. Every aspect of life should be governed by the law of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Alladhi khalaqakum, who has created you? He is your creator. He is your Rabb, your sustainer. O Badu Rabbakum, be bondsmen to your sustainer, to your master, to your Lord. Alladhi khalaqakum. And not only that, he is your sustainer, he is your creator. وَالَّذِينَ مِنْ قَبْلِكُمْ. And he created those also who were before you. Because people generally tend to follow their forefathers. Because our forefathers believed in such things, we also believe in such things. Because our forefathers were doing like that, we are also doing like that. We have to follow our forefathers. No. They were also created by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Just as you are the creator of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, they were also the creators. If you can commit mistakes, they could also commit mistakes. So not to follow them, but you follow the directions of Allah, the guidance given to you by your Lord, your Master, your Sustainer, your Creator. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. The same word again, taqwa. So that you may become pious, you may become God-fearing, no. So that you can save yourself. Save yourself from the displeasure of Allah. Save yourself from the punishment of the Day of Judgment. Save yourself from the fire of hell. لَعَلَّكُمْ تَتَّقُونَ. الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضِ. Who is that Allah about whom you are required to obey and to be bondsmen? He is He, الَّذِي جَعَلَ لَكُمُ الْأَرْضَ فِرَاشًا. Who made this earth for you as a resting place, just as a bedding. You know, first, so He has made this earth for you as a bedding. وَالسَّمَاءَ بِنَاءً. And then He raised the canopy of sky over you. وَأَنزَلَ مِنَ السَّمَاءِ مَاءً. And He sent down water, rain, from the sky. فَأَخْرَجَ بِهِ. And then He created from the earth, brought out from the earth, مِنَ الثَّمَرَاتِ رِزْقًا لَكُمْ. The provisions for you in the form of the fruits and the grains. فَلَا تَجْعَلُوا لِلَّهِ أَنْدَادًا وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. So don't declare, don't accept with Allah anyone as rival, as equal. Nobody is equal to Allah. Nobody is like Allah. Nobody is rival to Allah. The bondsman, you have to be for Him only. Nobody else. All humans are equal. كُلُّ عِبَادَ اللَّهِ أَخْوَانًا. You should be all bondsmen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala and brothers to each other. وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. At least you don't do it knowingly. Maybe a person is mistaken, and mistakenly he is doing something, that is something else. But knowingly, intentively, with intention at least, you shouldn't do it. وَإِنْ كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبِ اللَّهِ. We find in these two ayat, the essences of tawheed. Don't declare or accept anybody, anything equal to Allah, rival to Allah. This is tawheed. And the amali tawheed, the practical tawheed, be bondsmen to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Obey Him, worship Him, love Him, and serve Him from the depths of your heart. This is the basic call of the Quran. Now the second article of faith is risala, messengerhood, prophethood. And about the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, now we find these two ayat. وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا. If you are really in some doubt about that thing which we have sent down on our bondsman honor a servant Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. If you are doubtful about it, if you think that maybe that he is composing these surahs himself and he is saying that these have been revealed to me from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, if you have any doubts, if you have real doubts, وَإِن كُنْتُمْ فِي رَيْبٍ مِمَّا نَزَّلْنَا عَلَىٰ عَبْدِنَا فَاتُوا بِسُورَةٍ مِنْ مِثْلِهِ, then you also can produce, if you can, try to produce one surah like this Qur'an. I am keeping the word saying, one surah, مِنْ مِثْلِهِ, like the surahs of Qur'an. And as you know, the surahs are very small also. There are three surahs comprising of three ayat only. So the challenge goes to that extent. If you can comprise and compose a surah consisting of three ayat only, and if you can claim that this is equal to Qur'an, this is like Qur'an, this is at the same level of literary level as that of Qur'an, then you know you will have some right to doubt the authenticity of Qur'an, whether Muhammad is himself composing them or actually they have been revealed to him by Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَدْعُوا شُهَدَاكُمْ مِنْ دُونِ اللَّهِ, and you call all your witnesses and helpers, except Allah all the jinns, because there were kahins among them, and they had the jinns with them, so they could also get the help of the jinns. Then they had the very big orators in Arabia, then the poets, they were very proud about their literature, about their poetry, they thought we are the biggest orators. So you call all the people whom you can call, in kuntum sadiqin, if you are really true, if you are truthful, what does it mean? It means that you really don't doubt it. It's only, you saw, it's an explanation that you are giving forth. It's nothing. You really don't doubt that this is not the kalam of Allah. Your hearts have accepted that this cannot be composed, this Quran, by any human being. It's only your verbal argument that you are presenting. Otherwise, lame excuses that you are presenting. Otherwise, you don't actually believe from the depth of your heart that this is from Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. That is why Quran says, إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. If you are true, in your objection, in your doubts, then come and have, you know, then try to compose one surah, even one surah, or like then the surah of Quran. فَإِن لَمْ تَفْعَلُوا, and then if you can't do it, if you don't do it, وَلَنْ تَفْعَلُوا, this is very important. The emphasis, the confidence with which Quran is saying, you will never be able to do it. It's a miracle in itself that nobody challenged that we have some poet amongst us who can compose three lines just like Suratul Asr or Suratul Nasr or Suratul Kawthar. Nobody challenged. Nobody came forward to accept this challenge of the Quran. And Quran says it preemptively. وَإِلَّمْ تَفَعْلُوا وَلَمْ تَفَعْلُوا, and if you don't do it, if you don't accept the challenge, if you don't try to produce something like Quran, and you will never be able to do it. فَاتَّقُوا النَّارَ الَّتِي وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ, then you should try to save yourself. Be fearful of the fire of hell, whose fuel would be men as well as stones. Why stones? Because they used to worship, their idols were made out of stone. When you will be thrown in the fire of hell, these idols, these gods of yours, they will also be thrown with you in the same fire of hell. وَقُودُهَا النَّاسُ وَالْحِجَارَةُ عُدَّتْ لِلْكَافِرِينَ, and that has been prepared for the disbelievers. وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, now, in addition to the Iman bil Risala, there we find now Iman bil Akhirah. Because this Jahannam, fire of hell, is a matter concerning Akhirah. When the mention of hell came, now side by side, the mention of Jannah, the mention of heaven is also coming. وَبَشِّرِ الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا وَعَمِلُوا الصَّالِحَاتِ, and O Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, give good tidings to those who come to believe, and then they perform good deeds. أَنَّ لَهُمْ جَنَّاتٍ تَجْرِي مِنْ تَحْتِهَا الْأَنْهَارُ, that for them there are those gardens underneath which rivers will be flowing. كُلَّمَا رُزِقُوا مِنْهَا مِنْ ثَمَرَةٍ رِزْقًا, whenever they will be given some fruit of that garden for their food. قَالُوا هَذَا الَّذِي رُزِقْنَا مِنْ قَبْلِ They will say, this is the same thing that we was being given before this. That what does it mean? That the fruit of Jannah, fruit of heaven will be in form and shape. They will be like the fruit of this world. The grapes of this world, the pomegranate of this world, all these things, the dates of this world. But the taste of these very fruits of Jannah will be absolutely different. No comparison. وَتُوبِهِ مُتَشَابِهَا They will be given things which will be compared to each other, resembling each other. وَلَهُمْ فِيهَا أَزْوَاجٌ مُطَحَّرَةٌ And for them there will be wives, or some people have translated spouses. Wives for men, husbands for women. There will be spouses, مُطَحَّرَةٌ Who will be free from all evil. مُطَحَّرَةٌ وَهُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ And they will remain in them forever, forever, everlasting. Now these are the three articles of faith to which Qur'an is calling. This is the basic call of the Qur'an. Have belief in Allah and His oneness, unity of Allah. And obey Him from the depths of your heart in all aspects of your life. Believe in Qur'an, believe in the prophethood of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. And His biggest miracle is Qur'an. And if you have any doubts, well, accept the challenge of Qur'an. Come and compose even one sura just like Qur'an. And if you can't do it, and you will not be able to do it, so then you should fear the fire of hell. And there is a good guidance for those who believe in Allah and they do good deeds. Now, some missionary problems or phenomena. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِيَ يَغْرِبَ مَثَلًا مَا بَعُوْضَةً فَمَا فَوْقَهَا Verily, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not ashamed to set forth a parable, even of a mosquito. When you have to give a parable or a simile, actually it doesn't matter with what thing you are comparing anything. There should be some similarity, some resemblance, because always a similitude or a parable is given to explain something with relation to some another thing which is known already to a person. So there should be a connection, logical relationship between the two. Not that something should be great. If you are going to give an example for something great, then something great is to be mentioned. If you are going to give an example for something which is very small, then something small is to be mentioned. So Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala is not ashamed of giving examples even of mosquitoes. What to speak of something more if it is greater or smaller than that thing. فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا Why this has been discussed? Because all these things, the punishments in heaven and what are the blessings, the punishments in the hell and the blessings of heaven, wordings are the same which we use here. Nar, fire. But that fire of hell is not like the fire of this world. There is no comparison. In the same way, the things which we know here, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given the names of the Jannah also in the same way. But there is a world of difference between the essence of both the things. Names are the same. So these are, so to say, similitudes. These are parables. إِنَّ اللَّهَ لَا يَسْتَحِيَ يَدْرِبَ مَثَلًا مَا بَعُوضَةٌ فَمَا فَوْقَهَا فَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ So those people who believe, they know, they come to know for sure that this is haq, this is true from their Lord. Because it is actually within human beings, their root, their spirit, which testifies that this thing is correct. So, أَمَّا الَّذِينَ آمَنُوا فَيَعْلَمُونَ أَنَّهُ الْحَقُّ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ They don't see that what words are being used in a simile. They look to the essence of that simile or similitude. And then they immediately come to the conclusion that verily it is from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. وَأَمَّا الَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا فَيَقُولُونَ مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا And those who have denied, who have refused to accept, who have declared to be kuffar, they say, they object to it. مَاذَا أَرَادَ اللَّهُ بِهَذَا مَثَلًا What has Allah intended by this parable or by this similitude? يُزِلُّ بِهِ كَثِيرًا وَيَهْدِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا It is in this way that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala guides many people towards right and misguides others towards wrong. يُضِلُّ بِهِ كَثِرٌ. With this very Qur'an, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala misleads many people according to their intentions, because their intentions were not pure. From these parables of the Qur'an also, they get misguided. Instead of getting the guidance to the right path, they are misguided. They add to their misguidance from Qur'an also, because their intentions were not correct. And this is explained in the next ayah. وَيَهْدِي بِهِ كَثِيرًا. And but those people whose intentions are correct, who are muttaqeen, who want to save themselves from wrong and error and falsehood, and who want to save themselves from the fire of hell, they get the guidance from this Qur'an. وَمَا يُضِلُّ بِهِ إِلَّا الْفَاسِقِينَ. And Allah doesn't mislead or misguide except those who are rebellious in nature. Fisq means a rebellious nature. Who are in rebellion against Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, only them Allah misguides. As I said, it is based on the intentions, their own inclinations. If the inclination is bad towards wrong, Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will mislead him. If the inclination, intention is correct, if he is sincere in his intention, then Allah will guide him. Who are those fasiqeen? The rebellious people, disobedient people. الَّذِينَ يَنْقُضُونَ عَهْدَ اللَّهِ مِنْ بَعْدِ مِيثَاقِهِ. Who break Allah's covenant after accepting that. That covenant will be discussed in Surah Al-A'raf. That when we were in the form of spirits only, or you may call souls only, there were no bodies. Allah created all human beings, but in the form of spirits only. And from those about which the Prophet has said in one of the ahadith, Al-arwahu junudun mujammada. Those spirits were like armies, all the human beings which were to come in this world till the doomsday. The spirits of all were created at one time. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a covenant from them. Alastu bi rabbikum? Qalu bala. This will be discussed in Surah Al-A'raf. Am I not your Lord, your Master? And they said, yes, why not? We accept you as our Lord, our Sustainer, our Master. This covenant every human being has done and confirmed with Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, has ratified with him this treaty before coming to this world. So actually, those people who are rebelling against that covenant, after making it, after ratifying it, after accepting it, وَيَقْتَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِأَيُّ سَلَىٰ. And they cut what Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has ordered or decreed to be joined. For example, the relations, parents and the offspring, the brothers and sisters. Now this kith and kin, this relationship should be maintained, it should be respected. But they are breaking and cutting these relations. وَيَقْتَعُونَ مَا أَمَرَ اللَّهُ بِأَيُّ سَلَىٰ وَيُفْسِدُونَ فِي الْأَرْضِ. And they are doing mischief in this earth. أُولَٰئِكَ هُمُ الْخَاسِرُونَ. These are the people who are losers. They will be the losers. They will be in great loss on the day of judgment. كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ. A very beautiful question. Although it's not a question, it's a sign of exclamation. كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ. How do you disbelieve in Allah? How you reject Allah? How dare you reject Allah? كَيْفَ تَكْفُرُونَ بِاللَّهِ. وَكُنْتُمْ أَمْوَاتًا فَأَحْيَاكُمْ. And you were dead, and then he revived you and brought you to life. ثُمَّ يُمِيتُكُمْ. Then he will put you under death. He will make you to die. ثُمَّ يُحْيِيكُمْ. Then again, he will bring you to life. Now this is actually philosophical question of Quran. We were dead before coming to this world. What does it mean? We were not non-existent. A dead thing is an existing thing. Dead body lying, it's not living, dead body. But it is not non-existent, it is existing. So we were existing, but in the state of death. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala revived us, brought us to life. Then he will again put us to death. And then he will again revive us. Now out of these things we know this life, we know the death which is coming after this life, and then we know the resurrection that we will be brought to life again on the day of resurrection. But the first thing, mostly people ignore it. Actually we were dead, what does it mean? we were only in the spiritual forms before coming to this world. And we were asleep. Just as you know, in a cold storage, all the souls, the spirits of human beings were created at one time. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala took a covenant from them, أَلَفْتُ بِرَبِّكُمْ قَالُوا بَلَىٰ and put them to sleep. And this sleep actually is the condition of death. Then you might be remembering the supplications and the prayer of Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. When he woke up every morning, what was the prayer? Alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyani ba'dama amatani wa ilayhi nushur. All praise will be to Allah who has again brought me to life after he had put me to death. And in the same way, one day I shall rise from the sleep of death and will go to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, return to him. Alhamdulillahi alladhi ahyani ba'dama amatani wa ilayhi nushur. So actually sleeping is also life. That it has something similarity between the two. There is a similarity. So we were then, what does it mean? We were asleep as spirits. Then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave us this body in this world. We came here with the soul as well as this body. Then we shall die. The soul will return to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This body will return to this clay, to this earth again from which it has come. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala will again bring us from this very clay. مِنْهَا خَلَقْنَاكُمْ وَفِيهَا نُعِيدُكُمْ وَمِنْهَا نُخْرِجُكُمْ تَارَةً أُخْرَى. So these are the stages of human life. This ayah has a very important philosophical connotation. But this subject will be discussed in very clear terms in Suratul Ghafir or Suratul Mumin. That is the 24th part of the Quran. هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. Again, you know, a very philosophical issue. It is He who has created for you whatever is on the earth. Very important that man is the central creation of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. He has created this universe for man. That is why there is a hadith of the Prophet sallallahu alayhi wa sallam, إِنَّمَا الدُّنْيَا خُلِقَتْ لَكُمْ وَإِنْتُمْ خُلِقُمْ لِلْآخِرَةِ. This world has been created for you and you have been created for Akhirah. هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا. The same subject will continue in the next section. That is why the subject of Khilafah is discussed in the next section. Because this world has been created for you. You are going to be the Khalifa for this world, for this earth. So actually the same subject has been discussed here, which will be discussed in full length in the next section. هُوَ الَّذِي خَلَقَ لَكُمْ مَا فِي الْأَرْضِ جَمِيعًا ثُمَّ اسْتَوَى إِلَى السَّمَاءِ. Then he turned towards the skies. فَسَوَّاهُنَّ سَبْعَ سَمَاوَاتٍ. And then he divided them into seven skies. وَهُوَ بِكُلِّ شَيْءٍ عَلِيمٍ. And he knows everything. Everything is in his knowledge. Now the next section, which I told you, is of the utmost philosophical importance. And the basic subject, first of all, is that of caliphate. وَإِذْ قَالَ رَبُّكَ لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ إِنِّي جَاعِلٌ فِي الْأَرْضِ خَلِيفَةً. And just remember the time when your Lord said to the angels, I am going to place a vicegerent on earth. قَالُوا أَتَجْعَلُ فِيهَا مَنْ يُفْسِدُ فِيهَا وَيَسْفِكُ الدِّمَاءَ. They said, you will place therein those who will make mischief therein and shed blood. وَنَحْنُ نُصَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ. And we, while we are glorifying you, نُصَبِّحُ بِحَمْدِكَ and praising you, وَنُقَدِّسُ لَكَ and all that is associated with that. قَالَ إِنِّي عَالَمُ مَا لَا تَعْلَمُونَ. Allah said, I know what you don't know. Why I want to place a Khalifa on earth? What is the good in it? You can't comprehend. You don't have all the knowledge. I have the knowledge, I have decided it. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Now this is the position of man on earth. And the basic difference is that the modern civilization has reduced the position of man to that of an animal. No basic difference between animals and man. Only quantitative difference, no qualitative difference. A slightly more evolved animal. That's all. No difference. Why Quran says no. Man is vicegerent of Allah on earth. What a difference. What a hell of difference between the two. The position of man, Ashraful Makhlukat. In different verse Quran has described it. خَلَقْتَهُ بِيَدَيَّ. I have created this man with both of my hands. These words you'll find later on in the Quran. وَلَقَدْ كَرَّمْنَا بَلِي آدَمَ وَحَمَلْنَاهُ فِي الْبَرِّ وَالْبَحْرِ. We shall translate it in Surah Bani Israel, inshallah. So this is the first philosophical issue, that the position of man is very high. He is vicegerent of Allah on earth. وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. Now the second issue. That the basis of this caliphate is the knowledge that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to Adam. And he taught, وَعَلَّمَ آدَمَ الْأَسْمَاءَ كُلَّهَا. He taught to Adam all the names of all the things. Now actually this human knowledge you must know, it comprises of terms, terminologies, names. Man discovers some truth, some knowledge, and then he gives it a name. And with these names, human knowledge progresses. With the terminology, every science has its terminology of its own. Unless you have a full understanding, a basic understanding, a deep understanding of the basic terminology of that science, you can't comprehend it and you can't proceed with it. So actually all human knowledge, we can say is the knowledge of names. Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave Adam the knowledge of the name of everything. Potentially, just as we say that in a seed, the whole tree is present potentially. Where from comes the tree? From the seed. Actually the seed is the representative of the whole of the tree. In the same way, potentially, all human knowledge, acquired human knowledge, scientific knowledge, technology, that was actually given, it potentially to Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. What does it mean? Adam was given the faculties through which he could attain all this knowledge. Inna sam'a wal basara wal fu'ada kullu ulaika kana anhu masula. And this acquired human knowledge is progressing through these faculties of Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. فَقَالَ أَمْبِعُونِي ثُمَّ عَرَضَهُمْ عَلَى الْمَلَائِكَةِ. And then Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala showed them all those things, presented those things to the angels. فَقَالَ أَمْبِعُونِي بِأَسْمَاءِ هَؤُلَاءِ إِن كُنْتُمْ صَادِقِينَ. And said, now let me know, you tell me the names of all these things, if you are true in what you said. If you, the objection that you raised, or the question that you raised, that should be a better word. Now, if it is true, now you tell me the names of all these things. قَالُوا سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا. All of them said, glory be to you. You be glorified, Subhanak. لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا. We have no knowledge except the knowledge that you gave us. And most of the Mufassirin say that what it means is that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala has given to all the angels the knowledge of their own particular job. Different angels have been given different duties in this universe. And the knowledge only regarding that part of their duty, that of the universe, that knowledge is given to them, not an all-comprehensive knowledge of all the things. While man was given the faculty of getting a comprehensive knowledge of everything, so that was the basic difference. سُبْحَانَكَ لَا عِلْمَ لَنَا إِلَّا مَا عَلَّمْتَنَا. This was true about Adam also. Adam could also know anything, couldn't know anything without Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala telling him the names of those things. So Allah ta'ala told him the names, and that is why he could say, and you could tell the angels the names of all the things. But here they actually, what the meaning is, that the knowledge, extent of knowledge of the angels is limited to the particular work or the duty assigned to them. And it's not comprehensive. While Adam was given the faculties through which he could get all comprehensive knowledge. إِنَّكَ أَنْتَ الْعَلِيمُ الْحَكِيمُ. Verily only you are the only person who knows everything and who has all the wisdom. قَالَ يَا آدَمُ أَمْبِهُمْ بِأَسْمَائِهِ. Allah said to Adam, O Adam, you tell them their names. فَلَمَّا أَمْبَاهُمْ بِأَسْمَائِهِ. And when he told them all the names, قَالَ أَلَمْ أَقُلْ لَكُمْ إِنِّي عَلَمُ غَيْبَ السَّمَاوَاتِ وَالْأَرْضِ. Allah said to the angels, didn't I tell to you
Didn't I tell you that I know all the things, all the ghaib, all the unseen realities of the skies as well as of the earth? وَعَلَمُ مَا تُبْدُونَ وَمَا كُنْتُمْ تَكْتُمُونَ. And I know all that you make clear and you speak out, and all those things also which you had been hiding or concealing. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ. Now this is again a very important question. Because Adam was made the vicegerent of Allah, now all the civil service of this divine kingdom that was put under him, because when he is the vicegerent, when there was a viceroy, British viceroy in Delhi, the whole machinery, government machinery was under him. Only Allah was above Adam, and all the angels have been put under him. They had to obey him. That is why, you know, we have reached moon. No angel has intercepted our way, or no angel has come in the way. No, none. They had to obey us. Because we were given the faculty of knowing the hidden truths of this universe, the physical laws, the laws of the nature. We are knowing one by one. We are exploiting them. And all the angels have to obey. Even if somebody is going and committing a sin, the angels don't stop him. Because he was made the vicegerent. And he was given the option. Imma shakara wa imma kafura. He's going for committing theft, then let him go. Rather, we can't move even an inch. If these angels who are controlling the whole of this universe, if they don't allow, we can't walk one step. But actually now, all the angels, the whole civil service of this universal government has been put under Adam. And for as a symbolic phenomenon, now they were asked and they were ordered to prostrate before Adam. وَإِذْ قُلْنَا لِلْمَلَائِكَةِ اسْجُدُوا لِآدَمَ فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ. And remember the time when we said to the angels, bow before Adam, prostrate before Adam. فَسَجَدُوا. And they all prostrated. And at one place we shall find, فَسَجَدَ الْمَلَائِكَةُ كُلُّهُمْ أَجْمَعُونَ. All the angels, all of them, they prostrated before Adam. إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ. Accepting Iblis. Now here, somebody can doubt that Iblis was also an angel. Because when these words, if we keep them before us, فَسَجَدُوا إِلَّا إِبْلِيسَ, all the angels, they prostrated except Iblis. So it appears, apparently, that Iblis was also from the angels. It's not so. Because in Surah Al-Kahf, that is Makki Surah, it has been made clear, كَانَ مِنَ الْجِنِّ فَفَزَقَ عَمْرِ رَبِّهِ. He was from among the jinnat. He was a jinni, but he was very knowledgeable, he was very pious, and because the jinns were created out of fire, and the malaika, the angels were created out of noor, light, and fire and light, they are very close to each other. In Arabic, noor and nar, they are very close in root, noor and nar, waw and alif, and they are rufa'illah, and these rufa'illah, they get interchanged. So Noor and Naar are very close to each other. Malaika from Noor. There is a hadith in Sahih of Imam Muslim, and the narrated is Hazrat Aisha radiallahu ta'ala anha, that Allah created the angels out of Noor, out of light. And this has been given in Quran, that the jinns were created out of fire. So actually they are very close. So this jinn, he was very pious, and he was very knowledgeable, and he was very close to the angels, and so he was also supposed to prostrate along with the angels. But he, abā wastakbara wa kāna min al-kāfirīn, he refused, took to pride, and became proud of him, and he was among the disbelievers and against disobedient people. Wa qulnā ya ādam uskun anta wa zawjuka al-jannah. And we said to Adam, O Adam, now stay you, dwell you and your wife, al-jannah, in the garden. Now which garden is it? Is it the garden of heaven, or it was some garden of this very earth? There is a difference of opinion. Most of the Muslim mufassirin think that this is the heaven, some garden which was in heaven. Adam was created in the heaven and then he was sent down to this earth. This is the general perception. But Bible, Injil says that this garden was on this very earth. And Eden, Adam, this garden of Eden, somewhere in this area which is now inhabited by the Kurds. This is an elevated area. And here they say it was a place where Adam and Hawa alayhi wasalam were kept. But here is a difference of opinion among the Muslims also. But general opinion among the Muslims is that this was in the heaven. But it was not the heaven to which the Ahl-e Iman will be returned after resurrection. No. Because from that heaven, someone has entered, he will never be turned out. This was some place in which Adam was placed for some time as a testing period to give him an exhibition of what was to happen with him and his progeny. Because Iblis was his enemy, he will try his hardest to take them astray, away from the right path. So it was a manifestation of this phenomenon for this period. Adam was kept in that garden. Ya Adamuskar anta wa zawjukal jannah wa kula minha ragadan haythu shi'tuma. And now you eat from this garden with pleasure and delight from wherever you like, from whichever tree you like. وَلَا تَقْرَبَ هَذِهِ الشَّجَرَةِ. But don't go near this tree. Now هَذِهِ is with a finger pointing towards a particular tree. Quran doesn't discuss it, what tree it was. But there are different traditions and different opinions, and there's no need of going into detail. Because for testing you can fix anything. You can take everything except this. And this will be a test whether you can obey this commandment or not. Because if you touch this thing, then you have disobeyed. You are allowed to touch everything here except this thing. So actually, hadhihi shajara, so there is a pointing as if with a finger. Don't go near this tree. Fatakuna min al-zalimin, then you will be among the wrongdoers. Fazallahuma shaitanu anha. But the shaitan, that Iblis, he made them slip, both of them. Azallahuma, Adam and Eve, both. Ash-shaytan, this Iblis made them slip. فَأَخْرَجَهُمَا مِمَّا كَانَ فِيهِ. And he made them turn out. أَخْرَجَهُمَا. And get them out from that place or from that condition in which they were. وَقُلْنَا اهْبِطُوا مِنْهَا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌّ. And we said, now you go down from here. And you will be enemies to each other. Iblis and Adam, now they are enemies forever. Iblis was granted a very long life till the end of this world. He is living. He himself, personally, Azazil, that jinn, whom we call Iblis, whom we call Shaitan, he is living. Because we find it that he prayed to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala, grant me this long life, and I will prove to you that Adam is not faithful to you. And Adam's progeny, most of them, you will find that they will not obey you, they will not worship you. I will prove this point. If you give me this long life, and that long life was given to him. So now, this is the basis of all this struggle between good and bad, evil and good, and haq and batil, falsehood and reality. This is actually a war going on between Iblis and Adam, the progeny of Iblis, progeny of Adam, the agents of Iblis, and the agents of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. قُلْنَا اهْبِطُوا بَعْضُكُمْ لِبَعْضٍ عَدُوٌّ وَلَكُمْ فِي الْأَرْضِ مُسْتَقَرٌّ وَمَتَاعٌ إِلَى حِينٍ. And now you, for you, in the earth, there is a place to dwell and some provision for a time which has a limit, إِلَى حِينٍ, which is limited because this earth, life on earth will not go forever. A time will come, which we call the doomsday. This whole thing will be finished. فَتَلَقَّى آدَمَ مِنْ رَبِّهِمْ كَلِمَاتٍ فَتَابَ عَلَيْهِ. I told you before also that on this there was a repenting in the heart of Hazrat Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. I committed a mistake, I committed a sin, I disobeyed Allah. I believe this shaitan, who is my enemy. فَتَلَقَّ آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ. He wanted to apologize and repent to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. But he couldn't find words, proper words for it. So it was the mercy of Allah, the blessing of Allah, that he himself taught him the words. And those words appear in Suratul Araf, inshallah we shall read. رَبَّنَا ظَلَمْنَا أَنفُسَنَا وَإِنْ لَمْ تَغْفِرْ لَنَا وَتَرْحَمْنَا لَنَكُونَنَّ مِنَ الْخَاسِرِينَ. فَتَلَقَّ آدَمُ مِنْ رَبِّهِ كَلِمَاتٍ. And Adam was given, and Adam received some sentences, some words from Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. And Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala pardoned him on his repentance, accepted the repentance from him. إِنَّهُ هُوَ التَّوَّابُ الرَّحِيمُ يَقِينًا. Verily, he is the acceptor of tawbah and repentance. And he is merciful. قُلْنَا هَبِطُوا مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا. And we said, now go down all of you from here. Hubut we shall find in the next section, inshallah, that it means going down from one place which is higher to a place which is lower. And this word is used for settling down also. From Bedouin life to settled life in towns and cities, this is also hubut. This will come in Quran in the next hour, inshallah. قُلْنَا هَبِطُوا مِنْهَا جَمِيعًا فَإِمَّا يَأْتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدًى. Now whenever there comes some guidance to you from me, فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَا. So whosoever will follow and obey my guidance, فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَعْزَنُونَ. There will be no fear for them, nor shall they grieve. وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا. As for those who disbelieve and belie our ayat, our signs. Now these are two words. Kafaru, disbelieve. وَكَذَّبُوا, belie. You say it is a lie. And who those who disbelieve and belie our ayat, أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ. They are the people of fire, هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. And they will dwell in it forever. Now, as I told you, number one, in this section we find the position of man on earth. He is the vicegerent of Allah on earth. He has been given the command even over the angels. All the angels prostrated before him. So he has the authority here. He can do whatever he likes. Number three, he was given the faculties of acquiring knowledge of everything. This knowledge is going to those dimensions which are astonishing. Let me quote here a couplet from Allama Iqbal. Uruje aadam e khaki se anjum sehme jaate hain ki ye toota hua tara mahe kamil na ban jaye. This man, created of clay, where he is going, where he has reached, actually it is out of that knowledge, that faculty of knowledge, acquired knowledge. But in the end is the mention of the revealed knowledge. Imma yatiyannakum minni hudan. So these are two types of knowledge. One is the acquired knowledge, the scientific knowledge that we acquire through our senses, our intellect, our reasoning. The other is the given knowledge, the revealed knowledge, which comes through revelations, inspirations, through Anbiya, through prophets, these books of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. This is the second knowledge. Al-ilmu ilman. These are the two types of knowledge which we should understand discreetly, separately from each other. One knowledge is acquired through those faculties which were given to Adam alayhi salatu wa salam. And the other knowledge is given through wahi, through the prophets and messengers of Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. So in the beginning was the mention of the first knowledge, and in the end of this section is the mention of the second knowledge. فَإِمَّا يَاتِيَنَّكُمْ مِنِّي هُدًى فَمَنْ تَبِعَ هُدَايَ فَلَا خَوْفٌ عَلَيْهِمْ وَلَا هُمْ يَحْزَنُونَ وَالَّذِينَ كَفَرُوا وَكَذَّبُوا بِآيَاتِنَا أُولَٰئِكَ أَصْحَابُ النَّارِ هُمْ فِيهَا خَالِدُونَ. Now here the four first sections of this surah, they have been completed. I told you they are tabheedi. They are preliminary discussions. Now starts the section of 10 continuous sections of this surah, in which we find a direct address to Bani Israel, the former Muslim Ummah. Out of these 10 sections or 10 rukus, you can divide them into two. Now this analysis is very important, because you can keep these things in your mind through this analysis. The first section, comprising of 7 ayat, is very important, because this is the section of Dawah. Bani Israel are being called to accept the message of the Prophet of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. But from the second, or you should say from the sixth section, till the 15th or the 14th, that is actually a, so to say, charge sheet, a continuous charge sheet against that ummah. You did this thing wrong, you did this thing wrong, you broke the covenant here, you broke the promises with Allah there, and you created new things in your deeds, you are having wishful thinking about the akhirah, all these things. There is a continuous charge sheet against them, on the basis of which they were deposed from that position which was held by them for 2,000 years, being the representatives of Allah on earth. And then the Ummah of Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam was to be installed in the place of that former Ummah. So now this section, inshallah, we shall read. And that is 7 ayat which are very important. Ya Bani Israel, azkuru ni'mati allati anamtu alaykum wa awfu bi'ahdi ufi bi'ahdikum wa iyaya farhamun. O sons of Israel, Bani Israel, sons of Israel, O children of Israel. Israel is actually the laqab, title of Hazrat Yaqub alayhi salatu wassalam. In Hebrew language, Israel means Abdullah, bondsman of Allah. Israel, Eel is for Allah, Israel is for Abd. So Abdullah and Israel, they are the same. Abdullah in Arabic, Israel in Hebrew. Ya Bani Israel, azkuru ni'mati allati anamtu alaykum. O sons of children of Israel, remember my favor which I bestowed upon you, and fulfill your obligations of my covenant, so that I fulfill my obligations of your covenant with you. Ya Bani Israel, azkuru ni'mati allati anamtu alaykum, wa awfu bi'ahdi, ufi bi'ahdikum, wa iyaya farhabun, and fear nobody except me. Now this is the call given to Bani Israel. What was the covenant? That we shall read in ayah number 157 of Surah Al-A'raf. That they were, Hazrat Musa alayhi salam, he prayed for mercy for his nation, for his people, Bani Israel, forever. Allah said, my real mercy will be reserved for those of you who will believe in Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam. Al-Nabiyyul Ummi, Al-Rasul Al-Nabiyyul Ummi, who will come to them, and about whose signs there will be mentioned in Torah with them. Whosoever will believe in him and help him, then actually the best mercy will be reserved for those people. Of whom may ahdi? Now you must fulfill the obligation that you made the covenant with me, so that I fulfill my part of the covenant. وَآمِنُوا بِمَا أَنزَلْتُ مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا مَعَكُمْ. And believe in what I have sent down, that is Quran. مُصَدِّقًا لِمَا مَعَكُمْ, which testifies and confirms that which is with you. It is confirmed. Quran confirmed that Torah was given to Hazrat Musa alayhi salatu wasalam. It is a divine book. It was given, it is divine guidance. So it is confirming that which is with you. وَلَا تَكُونُوا أَوَّلَ كَافِرٍ بِهِ. And don't become the first kafirs and disbelievers. You should be the first to believe. You should be the first to accept him. Not to deny him, not to refuse to accept him. وَلَا تَشْتَرُوا بِآيَاتِ ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. And don't purchase and don't accept very tiny prices, very low price for what I have given you from these ayat, ثَمَنًا قَلِيلًا. وَإِيَّايَ فَاتَّقُونَ. And have fear only of me. وَلَا تَلْبِسُوا الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ. And don't mix falsehood with truth. Now, تَلْبِسُوا الْحَقَّ. Libas, what is libas? It is actually covers our bodies, our dress. So you cover the reality by something which is false. This Quran is real. The Prophet Muhammad sallallahu alaihi wasallam is real. And now you are trying to cover it. This is some false allegations. وَلَا تَلْبِسُوا الْحَقَّ بِالْبَاطِلِ. Don't cover haq, real reality, with batil, with falsehood. وَلَا تَكْتُمُوا الْحَقَّ. And don't try to conceal reality. وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Knowingly, when you know, you have recognized Muhammad sallallahu alayhi wa sallam due to his qualities that were mentioned in Torah, you have come to know that he is the last prophet, and you are trying to hide and conceal this truth. وَأَنْتُمْ تَعْلَمُونَ. Don't knowingly. وَأَقِيمُوا الصَّلَاةَ وَآتُوا الزَّكَاةَ. And establish the prayers These have all been, all the sharia that Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala gave to any of His messengers. The integral part has been salah. You must have some prayers. Although the forms have been different. Then rules and regulations have been different. Number of prayers have been different. But it has been an integral part of all divine sharia that there was namaz, there was salah, وَأَقِيمُ الصَّلَاةِ وَآتُ الزَّكَاةِ, and pay the charity that is compulsory charity. وَرْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ, and bow before Allah along with those who are going. Now this is actually a very good pointing towards the Muslims. You see the Muslims in this very city, you are dwelling in Medina, in your own city now, Muhammad and his companions, they are prostrating before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala in a congregation. Go and join that congregation. They are making ruku, they are making sajda, they are prostrating, they are bowing before Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. Why are you keeping away? وَرْكَعُوا مَعَ الرَّاكِعِينَ أَتَامُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْبِرِّ. Do you enjoin and order people towards goodness, good virtue, وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنْفُسَكُمْ, and you just forget yourselves. All the sermon is for others, not for you. All the good things and good deeds are for others, not for you. أَتَامُرُونَ النَّاسَ بِالْجُبْرِ وَتَنْسَوْنَ أَنْفُسَكُمْ وَأَنْتُمْ تَتْلُونَ الْكِتَابِ, and you are reading the book of Allah. This character of yours, how it is absolutely opposite, contradictory to the book of Allah that you read and you believe in. أَفَلَا تَعْقِلُونَ, don't you understand? وَاسْتَعِينُوا بِالصَّبْرِ وَالصَّلَاةِ, and seek help with patience and prayers. وَإِنَّهَا لَكَبِيرَةٌ, and this prayer is definitely very hard, except on those إِلَّا عَلَى الْخَاشِعِينَ, who have really submitted themselves to Allah subhanahu wa ta'ala. الَّذِينَ يَظُنُّونَ أَنَّهُمْ مُلَاقُوا رَبِّهِمْ, those who believe that they will have to meet their Lord, وَأَنَّهُمْ إِلَيْهِ رَاجِعُونَ, and that they have to return to Him anyhow. بارك الله لي ولكم في القرآن العظيم ونفعني وإياكم بالآيات والذكر الحكيم.